Welcome to GC208, Utilizing Nonverbal Cues in Counseling, Study Session 3. Introduction. In the previous study session, we were introduced to the principles of confidentiality in counseling, as well as the functions of counseling. In this study session, we will be introduced to utilizing nonverbal cues in counseling, learning outcomes. The end of this session, you should be able to explain utilizing nonverbal cues in counseling. Highlight the classification of nonverbal behaviors. Explain when and how to zero in on nonverbal. Utilizing nonverbal cues in counseling. What many counselors regard as nonverbal cues and commonly observed or noticed in counseling sessions has been given other names by several writers. For example, while Fast, 1970, called it body language or kinetics, Villard, 1976, called it analogic communication. Villard went further to explain the difference between verbal and nonverbal communication in the following way, that in our everyday interpersonal relationship, we listen both digitally and analogically. The digital part of our communication behavior tends to the verbal part of the message, that is the words we use, while the analogic part tends to the nonverbal part, such as hand gestures, facial expressions, and tone of voice. In short, in any counseling session, the counselor receives information from client and transmits information to them through two sources, verbal and nonverbal cues. Objectives of nonverbal cues. Colors of nonverbal language, such as Fast, 1970, Scherzer and Stone, T. Villard, 1976, and McGowan, 1962. To mention a few, I've discussed the purposes and objectives of nonverbal language in the counseling encounter or in ordinary human interpersonal relationship. For instance, Bird Whistle in Fast, 1970, believed that body language and spoken language are dependent on each other. He says that spoken language alone will not give us the full meaning. He went on to say that if we listen only to the words when someone is talking, we may get as much of a distortion as we would if we listen only to the body language. Villard is of the opinion that nonverbal language tends more than often to betray a person's secrets. That is, what a person keeps hidden in him, what he feels afraid of saying in words consciously, unconsciously. He cites the case of many patients who find it difficult to appropriately represent their feelings and thoughts in verbal terms, such as psychopaths, but who use actions to convey messages to others. On a more detailed level, Scherzer and Stone cites other authors such as Feldman and Ekman, who have done much work on the purposes and functions of nonverbal behavior. For instance, according to Feldman, nonverbal can be used by the client to assent or contradict verbal exchanges, that it can be used as an emblem to signify something, as an effort to show one's emotional disposition, etc. Classification of nonverbal behaviors. Villard and Scherzer and Stone, earlier referred to, have classified nonverbal language of behaviors into eight categories. It is important that we summarize the categories because of their importance to the work of the counselor. They are as follows. Physical traits or characteristics. These include facial features, body shape, body odors, etc. In relation to the exhibition or modification, all this is how the owner feels about any aspect or the totality of his body. Vocal characteristics, that is, sound made by human voice, by mouth, whether loud or soft, tone pitch, the speech reading, utterances such as easing, moaning, silence, as all these convey various meanings such as being happy, sound, angry, nervous, disgusted, and they generally express emotions and feelings. Body motion. This includes the various ways an individual can vary the motion and position of his body. Facial expressions, hand gestures, clenches or open hands, tightening of the lips, folding of arms across the chest, etc., which may indicate suppressed aggression, pride, good feeling about self, etc. Fast says that generally psychological attitudes usually affects body posture and functioning. Touch. By this we mean touching the body of another person, shaking hands, holding and massaging a person, feeling the body of another person or oneself. This may show the extent of familiarity or closeness and openness or otherwise to other people. Objects. This concerns the way an individual surrounds himself or utilizes the physical objects in his environment or displays material things. This includes the kind, color and style of clothes usually worn, whether clean or rough, the kind of vehicles usually preferred for use, the kind of electronic gadgets in one's possession, the kind of designs or posters in one's room or office, etc. All this tends to express the way a person perceives himself, modern or traditional in outlook, liberal or conservative in values, careless or careful, a status seeker or a contented person, etc. Refers to one's constant choice of sitting place, exhibiting an association with a particular place or club. This may include preference for sitting in front or at the back of a car designed for an association or an space utilization. This reflects the way an individual utilizes his physical space. This may include sitting at a distance or close to other people. This may mean readiness for association or adopting a leave me alone posture, which is a form of defense mechanism. Time utilization. This concerns an individual's concept and utilization of time. It may include attitudes to lateness, punctuality, and these are usually related to one's work and attitude to people generally. When and how to zero in on nonverbal cues in counseling. The right time to capitalize on nonverbal cues in counseling is generally not agreed upon by practitioners. Basically, there are three approaches to it. First, some practitioners feel it is better to pick up the cue as soon as it is omitted by the client or is elicited by the counselor. The merit of this approach is the fact that the cue is fresh, and immediately cashing in on it will tend to produce maximum effects, and that the counselor can quickly follow it up with more probing questions and interpretation or confrontation. Another approach commonly employed is to allow a small interval between the emission of the cue and the reaction of the counselor. It is also said that while delayed reaction will help the client to readjust, it may also emit secondary cues hoping that the counselor will not also do something about it, or to draw the attention of the counselor to his message. It is argued that the attention of several cues within a short period of 5 to 10 minutes will crystallize and lead to valid and reliable interpretations. Under such approach, some time is usually allowed to elapse before the counselor goes back to make comment, indirectly though, about the cue. This does not mean that the direct comment cannot be made, particularly if the cue is a non-threatening one. The third approach is simply to ignore the cue either immediately or thereafter, hoping that the ongoing intensive or in-depth interview will lead to results that of having a clearer understanding of the client, his problem and his message. However, the danger in non-recognizing of emitted cues is that the client may now see the counselor as an incompetent professional who cannot even recognize and decipher a cue, which if the client is using in place of verbalization due to the importance of he attaches to the particular feelings, which he finds difficult to put into words. Generally, the rule of the thumb is that the counselor should judge the prevailing mood of the client and also consider the relevance and importance of the emitted cues before deciding to utilize any of the three approaches outlined above. Interpreting nonverbal cues in counseling. Some writers have tried to interpret certain nonverbal behaviors. Such writers include Feldman, who has been cited by Schatzer and Stone. The following are of interpretations of certain nonverbal behaviors. Erect head means self-esteem, confidence and courage. Bowed head means humility, resignation, guilt and submission. Touching the nose means anxiety or stage fright. Artificial cough means criticism, doubt, surprise and anxiety. Pressing head with hands means distress, despair and helplessness. Placing head between the two palms means sadness, exhaustion, meditations, etc. The question is, are these interpretations universally accepted as valid? Fast has sounded a note of warning that we must avoid generalization in interpreting body language because an interpretation that is true for another, particularly in a diverse culture as ours, counselors must exercise caution in their interpretation of body language. He also warns that we should watch out for faking of body languages. In summary, he says that all the body signals must be added up to a correct total if a man uses body language effectively. Nick Gwan, in his own words of advice, says that there is need for the synchronization of verbal and non-verbal languages before any meaningful understanding of what is going on in the patient's during counseling relationship can be achieved. The caution against wild and generalized interpretation of body languages notwithstanding, counselors should attempt to possess a good command of body language and try to use it very well. Attempted interpretation of certain common non-verbal behavior in counseling. Case 1. A student is referred to the counselor by his teacher for uncontrollable behavior in class. The student comes to the counselor grudgingly, knocks the door very hard, enters and sits down folding his arms against his chest. Whatever the counselor says receives no answer. How is the behavior to be interpreted? Interpretation. I am not here out of my own free will, and so I am not going to talk to you or listen to you in what you have to say, and I don't want to discuss this issue with you. How can you get in talk? Case 2. A student who was suspected of stealing is sent to you by the principal of your school for counseling and possibly to find out the truth from him. He comes in a jovial mood and sits down confidently. As a counselor, how would you interpret this initial behavior? That they told lies against him and that he doesn't look like a boy who can steal. That he is only putting up a bold face as a form of defense mechanism. In the middle of your interview session, you cornered him as a result of adequate leading questions and probing. He then utters something inaudible and forces his face away from you thereafter. What does this mean? Interpretation. It is non-verbal language expressing a feeling of guilt and shame. Indirectly, he is saying, I am ashamed of what I did, so I cannot face you. Case 3. A 17-year-old girl in SS2 usually dresses gorgeously to school with heavy makeup and panned hairdo, and whenever she walks around the compound, the steps are always well calculated to match her neat and flashy appearance. Invariably, she is not doing well in most of her subjects. Why do you think she behaves the way explained above? Interpretation. She is indirectly putting up a mask to cover up her failing in academic work. She is saying, although I am not bright, yet my beauty and my elegance can protect me against the gossips of teachers and pupils. At least I can be proud of something. Case 4. A young boy of 12 years comes to you for counseling. The parents are divorced and he now lives with 4 stepmothers who do not care about him. While talking to you as the counselor, he starts to cry and says, what kind of life is mine? I am lonely and unloved. What do you think the verbal and non-verbal languages are communicating to you? Interpret. The young lad is loudly saying to you, counselor, if all others forsake me, you too should not desert me. Hold me close to yourself. Care for me. I need you. As a counselor, you must be all eyes and ears and be sensitive in order to pick up such non-verbal and verbal cues. Case 5. A tall and fat girl with heavy mammary glands comes in to speak to you because she is not succeeding in social and heterosexual relations. As the counseling proceeds, you fix your eyes on her and particularly on her breast intensely. She reacted by picking her big exercise book from the table and placing it across her chest. What do you understand by this non-verbal behavior? Interpretation. Her action shows her embarrassment at your non-verbal behavior. She believes that you are possibly confirming the idea that it is the big breast that is driving boys away. Another interpretation is that she thinks you are possibly looking at her breasts in order to take advantage of her situation and problem, so she protects her vulnerable breasts. She does not want you. She only needs your help. Case 6. This writer in graduate days in white man's country ran into a problem with his supervisor and lecturer. An argument ensued over the matter. The supervisor, who is an elderly man, believed that he was right, while this writer, a student, also believed that it was right. As the argument was getting out of hand, this writer, as a student, kept quiet and looked down. The supervisor then reported, "You see, you accept your fault. You know you are wrong. You see, that is why you now look down." Do you think the supervisor is right in his interpretation? Considering the differences in the culture of the student and supervisor, how would you interpret the non-verbal behavior of this writer? Case 7. An SS2 girl comes to you as a counselor to discuss some personal problems. You invite her to sit by your side or closely in front of you for the counseling session. As the session proceeds, your legs start to unconsciously touch hers, so also your elbows and her body. She starts breathing fast and her words become incoherent and she starts shrinking in her seat. What do you understand by her non-verbal behavior? Interpretation. She is trying to protect her territory because you are intruding it. She is also not sure if your actions are intentional or otherwise, but she is uncomfortable with what is going on, whereas she can't say it in words. The counselor must not move towards all. In fast, cause a close intimate distance, 6 to 18 inches. Otherwise, such a move will lead to uneasiness and embarrassment for both parties, but more so for the counselee. All suggests a far personal distance, 2.5 to 4 feet, which is close enough to permit privacy and still allow personal discussion. Summary for study session 3. In study session 3, you have learned that what many counselors regard as non-verbal cues and commonly observed or noticed in counseling sessions has been given other names by several writers. For example, White Fast, 1970, called it body language or kinetics. Villard, 1976, called it analogic communication. Scholars of non-verbal language such as Fast, 1970, Schatzer and Stone, 1980, Villard, 1976, and McGowan, 1962, to mention a few, have discussed the purposes and objectives of non-verbal language in the counseling encounter or in ordinary human and interpersonal relationship. For instance, Port Wistel in Fast, 1970, believed that body language and spoken language are dependent on each other. We have come to the end of study session 3. Thanks for listening.